Okay, the last colligative property is called osmotic pressure. And osmotic pressure is something that we have to learn how to operate by learning about osmosis first. With the other ones, we've already learned about vapor pressure, and we've learned what a boiling point and a freezing point are, so we didn't have to do this background. Let's do a little bit of background here, okay? Oh my goodness, I got stuff popping up, but no picture, so let's get right to the picture, and then I'll talk about the things around it, okay? So osmosis is defined this way, all right? It is the selective passage of solvent molecules, not the solute molecules, the solvent molecules through a porous membrane. Okay, so you take two solutions, one that's pure solvent and one that's a solution, and the solvent can migrate from one side to the other across that membrane. Now, they can go in both directions. There's solvent on both sides, but the way it tends to go is from the less concentrated, which if it was pure solvent, that would be less concentrated, towards the more concentrated. What it's trying to do is dilute out the more concentrated one until they can match, okay? Now this migration will occur and cause the volume to rise on one side, and we see that in the picture on the right, okay? The amount of volume it takes to rise will add added pressure on that side, and at some point it will stop, and you can make a measurement in tubes of the pressure that it took to do that. Or you could push down on one side and say how much pressure of pushing down is required to keep the levels the same, okay? And depending upon how different those two concentrations are will depend upon how much osmotic pressure it takes to keep that from migrating, okay? So we see in this image the porous membrane right down at the bottom of that U-tube. We see that we've got pure solvent on the left, we have solute and solvent dissolved in the solvent on the right, and there's a net migration to the right side of this, and that's what osmotic pressure is, okay? Now, the concentration of those particles on this one side is going to define the osmotic pressure, okay? So when you're making a comparison between the pure solvent and the concentration as it changes is going to change the osmotic pressure. And it will change it in a way that we'll see mathematically here in a little bit. Okay, so some terms associated with osmosis that you might run across in a biology class or maybe a biochemistry class has to do with the difference in the concentration of, let's say, the blood surrounding it. So we have the concentration maybe in the bloodstream versus the concentration in the cells. Okay? And what would happen to the cells in these situations. The first one is called hypotonic, which means the concentration in the bloodstream of ions is lower. Hypo is below. Lower concentration out here. Now we know that solvent will migrate, okay, from lower concentration to higher concentration. So what we see here is a migration of water into the blood cells, and what will happen is these things will swell and we see them bursting here. That is a hypotonic solution. So if you, I can think of a bad situation where maybe a mother who has formula and she's trying to save money by diluting down the formula. The baby is very, very hungry, so it's consuming a lot of the milk that was prepared for it, but it's way too much water, and so it dilutes out the bloodstream, and that could result in the bursting of the red blood cells. The right-hand side is called hypertonic. Okay, so it's got a high concentration of dissolved ions in the bloodstream. Well, the cells has lower concentration, they're going to try to dilute out the bloodstream. So we're going to have a net migration of the solvent, the water, out of the bloodstreams, and they actually dehydrate. And we see that happening here in the hypertonic. Now, where would that happen? Hypertonic will occur, let's say you're out on the ocean and you ran out of water and you're trying to quench that thirst by drinking salt water. Water, water everywhere, and not a drop to drink. You cannot drink that because your bloodstream will end up with a high concentration and you will end up causing those blood cells to shrivel. So iso means same. So an isotonic solution, of course, is what your bloodstream is trying to keep, is a nice even concentration around those cells versus the concentration inside of those cells. Now, what we want to focus on in a chemistry class is this relationship. And I've seen people just recently rearrange this so it spells something as well. There you go. Somebody says pie equals trim because you trim your pie crust when you make a pie. I don't know, but that having a word is always nice. Let's see this, where this comes from. This is the I and the M, and I'll get rid of my trim since I don't have my notes written that way. The I and the M, that's molarity, not molality, and we have the concentration of particles in molarity there. We have got the ideal gas constant, and we want to use the one that has a pressure unit in it because this is osmotic pressure and it's going to come out in atmospheres, okay? And we have our temperature, okay? It's going to need being Kelvin because our R has Kelvin in it, doesn't it? Now, this really pans out very, very similar to PV equals NRT. If you replace the P with pi, okay? P and pi go together. You replace the P with pi and move the V under, then moles per liter is molarity. So it works out unit-wise exactly the same way as PV equals NRT. But it's pi equals, you see it there, or you could remember it as trim. I like that. Okay, so I already told you that, what isotonic means, but it's molarity of particles. It's not molarity of just sodium chloride. It's everything dissolved would be isotonic. So let's work a problem. The problem here is asking us to determine the osmotic pressure of a solution. So as soon as I know that I'm trying to determine the osmotic pressure, I'll pull out my equation. I'll make my pen work a little bit better. Hang on a second. Okay, I think it's going to work better now. Maybe, maybe not. Pi, that's a capital pi, equals. And I'm going to do, because I like this new discovery, okay, the components that I need there. I'm trying to determine the osmotic pressure, so I need the temperature. I see it's 27 degrees Celsius. Well, 27 degrees Celsius plus 273 will get it to me in Kelvin. Okay, so I'll have my Kelvin. I know I need it in Kelvin. I use my R value. 0.08206, that's provided for you on our periodic table. Write the units down. That will remind you, liter atmospheres per mole Kelvin. If you hadn't put this down at Kelvin, as soon as you wrote that K, it would trigger in your mind, oh yeah, I need that in Kelvin. Okay. Well, what is being dissolved? Bunch of nonmetals, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, hydrogen. That is a non-electrolyte, so my I is 1. And now I need a capital M, I need molarity. Dang it, they didn't hand me molarity on a silver platter. So I'm gonna come down here and work my molarity. Capital M, it's moles of solute, which this solute is propyl alcohol, I'll call it PA for short, okay? I've got my moles per liter of solution. So I need those two things. They didn't give me moles of propyl alcohol, they gave me that I have 12.7 grams. But I know that I can go from grams to moles. So I go and determine the molar mass of propyl alcohol, and it's 60.11. 60.11 grams, that is the three carbons, the eight hydrogens, and the oxygen, that many grams per mole, and that's my numerator. My denominator is liters of solution. It's 500 milliliters of solution, that is 0.5 liters of solution. I just moved it over three decimal places, but you might need to do the work still to think about which way that decimal place needs to go. That gives for me a molarity equal to 0.422 moles per liter. Now, I could write it as a capital M, but I'm going to leave it that way, and let's see why I'm going to do that. 0.422 moles per liter. let's watch our units, okay? There's a liter and there's a liter. There's a mole, there's a mole. There's a Kelvin, and what am I left with? I am left with the atmospheres. That degree Celsius went away when I added a 273. So that is going to give me an osmotic pressure equal to, 10.4. 10.4, and what's the units? Atmospheres. Okay? So that is using the information to get osmotic pressure. Now, more commonly, you go and measure the osmotic pressure, and from that measurement, you can figure out the concentration. So if you have an unknown solution and you don't know the concentration, and you're trying to do a measurement of its concentration, you can measure the osmotic pressure and obtain a value for the molarity. So that would be more commonly what is done there. Okay, so we're going to stop here with this lesson, and then we're going to have one more lesson about colligative properties, and that is how we can use colligative properties to determine the molar mass of an unknown.